I wanted to speak this morning about a great danger in a Christian's life.
Ekuseni namhlanje ngithanda ukukhuluma ngengozi enkulu empilweni yomntwana kaNkuluNkulu.
Where a Christian can slide into a terrible, terrible state.
Lapho umzalwane engahlehlela esimeni esibi kakhulu.
And how we can recognize the danger signs in our lives.
Nokuthi singayibona kanjani impawu ezikhombisayo ukuthi kunobungozi empilweni yethu.
And take a warning to prevent us from sliding into that lukewarm state.
Bese sicwaye ukuba singaweli kuleso simo lapho sithola sizivivi ngokomoya.
God's word says that everything that was written up in order for us to learn from the mistakes of others.
Izwi likaNkulunkulu lithi konke okulotshiwe la kwalotshelwa thina ukuba kube yisibonelo sifunde ngamaphutha abanye.
Let's turn in God's word to Exodus chapter 32 verse 21.
Sizovula izwi likaNkulunkulu incwadi kaExodus isahluko samashumi amathathu nambili ivesi lika 21.
Now before we start reading, let me just paint the picture of where this took place. Moses led the children of Israel out of the land of slavery, out of Egypt. On the way to the promised land, and he led them a long distance through desert and dry places. And then came the time when God wanted to communicate the Ten Commandments and show Israel more of his heart towards them. It was a wonderful opportunity. They'd been waiting to get to know this God better who took them out of Egypt. So God called Moses up the mountain, where he spoke to Moses for approximately 40 days.
La akhuluma naye uNkulunkulu ekhulumisana noMose cishe izinsuku ezingamashumi amane.
And amongst other things, he gave Moses the Ten Commandments to give to the Israelites.
Kwezinye zezinto abayikhuluma lapho wayese enikeza uMose imithetho yeshumi ukuba ayinikeze abantwana bakwaIsrayeli.
Moses' face was shining in the presence of God. He was blessed. He was encouraged. He was strengthened. And it must have been with great joy that he thought, well, God has given us this law to guide us now. Until God spoke to Moses. He said, Moses, you've got to go back quickly down the mountain to the Israelites. Things have gone terribly wrong. They have forsaken me. And Moses rushed down the mountain. Just think of how his joy was just squashed. And as he came down to the camp, he saw the Israelites dancing around the old golden calf, drinking and partying and worshipping an idol. And he was so disappointed that he took the Ten Commandments, the two stone tables with the Ten Commandments, and threw them down the mountain and bashed them into pieces.
Wayesedangala kakhulu uMose ukuthi wathatha imithetho leyishumi ibibhaliwe kwizibhebhene zamatshe wayesekuphonsa phansi.
And he walked into the camp.
Wayesengena kulo ikamu.
City Stud said, a man of God on fire.
U-City Stud wathi indoda kaNkulunkulu esemlilweni.
One man against 3 million dancing devils, he said.
Wathi indoda eyodwa lekaNkulunkulu esisekelayo iyodwa kuphela kodwa ibhekene namademon adansayo ayizigidigidi.
He didn't blink an eye.
Akazange avale amehlo ukucimezela okwakwenzeka.
He was fearless.
Wayengenako ukwesaba.
The fear of God was in his heart.
Kodwa ukwesaba kukaNkulunkulu yikhona okwakusenhlizweni yakhe.
And when he got down, he heard that actually his brother Aaron had made the golden calf for them.
Umesefika kubona wayesethola ukuthi empeleni umfowabo Aaron obenzele lelithole legolide.
And he spoke to Aaron.
Wakhuluma no Aaron.
And we read there that in Exodus 32:21.
Siyayitholake leyo ndaba encwadini kaExodus isahluko samashumi amathathu nambili ivesi lamashumi amabili nanye.
And Moses said to Aaron, what did this people do to you that you have brought such a great sin upon them?
UMose wathi ku-Aaron, benzeni kuwe laba bantu ukuba ubehlisele isono esingaka na?
Moses said, what did these people do to you so that you brought this evil upon them again?
Uthi Mose, benzeni laba bantu kuwe ukuba wena ubehlisele ububo obungaka na?
You can look at this in two ways.
Ungayibuka le ndaba ngengxenye ezimbili.
Why did Aaron do this?
Ngani ukuba u-Aaron enze lesenzo na?
He saw all God's miracles in Egypt.
Ubonile zonke imangaliso zikaNkulunkulu eGibhithe.
He heard God speaking to them, to him and Moses.
Umzwile uNkulunkulu ekhuluma naye noMose.
How could he have changed so radically and made an idol for them?
Pho kwenza kanjani ukuba avela kuguquke kangaka nangumanje usebenzela isithixo?
Maybe he wanted to be popular with the people.
Mhlawumbe ubethanda ukuthi abe umuntu othandekayo kubantu.
Maybe he feared that they were going to stone and kill him because they were so worked up.
Mhlawumbe ubesaba ukuthi bazomshaya bamkhande ngamatshe bambulale ngoba labantu bese bevuke ubudlwangudlwangu.
People, the fear of people and the fear of the world is a terrible thing in a Christian's life.
Sihlobo ukumesaba uNkulunkulu, ukumesaba uJehova kuyinto edingekalayo empilweni yomKristu.
The desire to please people and to live before people is a terrible danger in a Christian's life.
Isifiso sokuthi uthokozise abantu, isifiso sokuthi uhambe kahle phambi kwabantu kuyinto eyingozi kakhulu empilweni yomKristu.
As that, don't we see that happening daily with our politicians?
Asikuboni lokho kwenzeka usuku nosuku kubaholi bethu bezepolitiki.
Men and women who were full of integrity before they got voted into government.
Abesilisa nabesifazana bebeqotho ngaphambili base bethola ikhundla kuhulumeni.
They lose their desire to be righteous.
Emva kwalokho balahlekelwe leso sifiso sokuthi kube abantu abalungile.
They lose their integrity and righteousness.
Balahlekelwe ukulunga kwabo nokuqotho babo.
They become corrupt and evil.
Babe abantu abagcwele ubugebengu nobubi.
Just to please Satan and the people.
Benza nje lokhu kuba bathokozisa abantu, bathokozisa uSatan.
Are you, allow me to ask you, friend.
Ake ngikubuze mhlobo.
Are you aware, as you try to follow God, are you constantly aware of what the world wants and of the idols and the golden calves of the world?
Njengoba uzama ukuthi ulandele uNkulunkulu, uyazi ukuthi izwe lifunani. Lilandelani ngawe ngalezi zithixo zalo.
Are you full? Is your life one continuous struggle against temptations, against the world?
Ingabo impilo yakho igcwele yini izilingo emva kwesinye umelene nezwe.
All you can do day and night is just resist temptations to make a golden calf.
Ukuthi njalo usuku nosuku busuku nemini ubhekene nokuthi ulwe nalesi silingo sokuthi wenze lelithole legolide.
You lack two things.
Uma kunjalo kunezinto ezimbili oyiswelayo.
Firstly, I say you've never really loved the Lord your God.
Okokuqala ngithi mina awukazi umthande ngokweqiniso uJehova uNkulunkulu wakho.
And then remember the Lord says he who has been forgiven a lot of sins forgiven, he will love a lot.
Khumbula ukuthi uJesu wathi lowo othethelelwe kakhulu onezono eziningi ezithethelelwe uzothanda kakhulu.
If you don't have the love of God in your heart,
uma ungenalo uthando lukaNkulunkulu
enhlizweni yakho, and you've been following people,
ulandela nje abantu,
not God,
ungalandeli uNkulunkulu,
you will be like Aaron.
Uzoba njengo-Aaron.
He wasn't called by God.
Wayengabizwanga uNkulunkulu.
Moses was called by God.
Umuntu wayebiziwe uMose.
Friend, have you ever been called by God?
Zihlobo ubiziwe yini uNkulunkulu?
Or are you just here because that's a good thing to do and people want you to do that?
Noma ulana njoba kuyinto enhle vele ukuba lana futhi baningi nabantu abathanda uthubela.
Moses called him to come and translate for him. He was called by Moses and not by God.
UMose wambiza umfobo Aaron ukuba azomhumushela. Akabizwanga uNkulunkulu, wabizwa uMose.
He was called by man.
Wabizwa umuntu.
And he didn't have the love for God in his heart.
Akabanga nalo uthando lukaNkulunkulu enhlizweni yakhe.
If a man doesn't love his wife,
uma indoda ingamthandi umakoti wayo,
and he hears all the laws of marriage,
bese alalele yonke imithetho emaqondana nomshado.
Now that you married,
kuthiwa ke njoba manje ushushadile,
you're supposed to love only your wife.
Kumele ubuthande umkakho yena yedwa.
You're not supposed to sleep with any other woman.
Awuvunyelwe ukuhlanganisa nomunye wesifazane.
You're not supposed to flirt with other women.
Awuvunyelwe ukuthi lokulandela abanye besifazane.
You're not supposed to kiss another woman.
Awuvunyelwe ukuthi wange omunye wesifazane.
You're not allowed and supposed to seductively touch another woman.
Awuvunyelwe ukuthi lokuthinta abanye besifazane.
If he does not love his wife,
uma engamthandi umkakhe,
he's going to say so many laws.
Izothi le ndoda awungaze ngafa imithetho engaka.
My goodness, it's so many laws. This is just one legal contract.
Athi awungeke yamningi kangaka le mthetho kube ngathi ngisayina inkontileke engibophayo.
I'm not going to get married to this woman.
Athi ungcono ngingashadi nalwesifazane.
You watch out people who cry all the time that there's too many laws in Christianity.
Okubabheka ubaPaul labo bantu abakhala njalo bethi miningi imithetho ekholweni.
They don't have a true love for God and the Son of God who purchased them with his blood.
Ingoba abanalo uthando ngoNkulunkulu nangendodana yakhe eyabathenga ngegazi.
That's why you come to a service and you just hear law, 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 and another person goes out of this person that come to a service and he just hear blessed advice to encourage him to follow the Lord.
Ingakho wena ungena enkonzweni into eyizoyo nje umthetho, umthetho kuphela. Kodwa umunye obekhona kuleyo nkonzo, uma ephuma yena, uzwa izeluleko ezimbusisayo zokulandela uNkulunkulu.
And because Aaron didn't have the love of God in his heart,
ngenxa yokuthi u-Aaron wayengenalo uthando lukaNkulunkulu enhlizweni yakhe,
he didn't love for the Son of God.
Wayengenalo uthando lwendodana kaNkulunkulu akayiphilelanga.
He didn't love for the day when he will leave this world.
Akaliphilelanga lolo suku la ezoshiya khona lomhlaba.
And he could put a smile on the face of his master, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Ukuba kwazi ukuthi ngalolo suku alethe ukujabula kwinkosi yethu Jesu
Christ. Oh, for the grace to put a smile on his face.
Ukuba nje basithola umuso ukuba silethe intokozo ebusweni benkosi yethu.
But if you see him on that great day,
ukuthi uma ngabe umbona ngalo suku olukhulu,
he will embrace you,
ukuba akwange,
and you will hear those blessed words,
bese uzwe lawo mazwi abusisekile,
well done good and faithful servant,
wenze kahle nceku enhle nethembekile,
you've been faithful over very little, I'll put you in charge of much. Do you have that love burning in your heart? If you have that love, you will have the right love to the people around you. Not the worldly love where you will help them to worship idols. But a love for the soul of man, souls of man. And that they should be saved and not go lost. Jesus had that love. When he saw the 5,000, the Bible says he looked at them and he felt pity for them. And he said they were to him like sheep without a shepherd. They had nobody to show them God's way. They had nobody to bring them to salvation. They had nobody to bring them to repentance. And that's the godly divine love that he had for people. Not the love where he would please the people and just do whatever they want in a worldly way and give them an idol. This second way to look at this verse. Moses said to him, What did this people do to you? That you have brought such a big sin upon them. That is often how temptation comes in life. Another person does something to you first. And if you don't act in the love of God, and you don't answer back and respond in the love of God, you are then going to do something back to them. Moses said, what did they do to you that you have brought such a big sin upon them? Maybe a person makes you cross and you get upset. He does something to you. Maybe he's unfair. Maybe he's attacking you without reason. And because of what he's doing to you, then you react back in a carnal, fleshly way with hatred, and you answer in a carnal way, and you hurt him. God is not going to call you one day and say, well, you know, why did you allow the people to force you to do this? You say, what did the people do to you? But the main point, that you brought such a big evil upon them. The worldly person is busy with, what did the people do to me? The child of God, whose heart is broken about his sin, is looking at what a great evil that I bring upon the other people. I hope we're not sitting here thinking about all the evil your drunk father and your immoral mother has been doing to you.
But
that you are aware of the evil that you have done to them and to the church of God and the kingdom of God. Christ's love never made him dance along around a golden calf. Actually, he went against the whole nation. Up to the point of his final death. Because he had a godly divine love for them. Tell me, friend, do you have the love of God for other people? Do you love them with the love of God? Or do you see them as a threat and a danger, and you're just aware of their mistakes? Maybe that was Aaron's problem. If we move on to verse 25, and I'm going to read the King James Version here about what Moses saw when he came down the mountain. And when Moses saw the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked unto their shame among their enemies. This is how God saw it. They were naked. Not necessarily that they were physically without clothes, but that they were naked in the sense that their shame was exposed. God says that in another place in his word. You don't have to turn there. In the book of Chronicles, he speaks and he says, "For the Lord brought Judah low because of Ahaz, the king of Israel." For Ahaz had made Judah naked. Against the Lord. If you lose your temper, if you start swearing, you are naked before God. If you go and sin in front of people, you are naked because you're exposing your own shame to them. If you look at a woman, man, and she sees the lust in your eyes, you are naked, not naked in an attractive sense, but in a despiseful way. What did Moses do further? Let's go to verse
26.
Then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, "Who's on the Lord's side? Come to me." And all the sons of Levi gathered around him. And he said to them, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, put your sword on your side, each of you, and go to and fro from gate to gate throughout the camp, and each of you kill his brother and his companion and his neighbor."
Etangeni lakhe adabule ikamu aye emuva ephambili kusukela kwelinye isango kuze kubekwe elinye isango lekamu yilona lo abulala umfo wabo nalo umngane wakhe nalo umakhelwane wakhe.
And the sons of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and that day about 3,000 men of the people fell.
Amadodana kaLevi enza njengezwi lika Mose kwawa ngalolo suku abantu kungathi abayizinkulungwane ezintathu.
It came to me,
kwafika kanjena kimi,
why did God punish those who sinned amongst the Israelites?
Ngani ukuba uNkulunkulu abahlulele labo abonile kusizwe sakwaIsrayeli
so severely,
abashaye ngendlela ebuhlungu kangaka?
But he didn't kill Aaron, who was the leader.
Kodwa akambulalanga uAaron okwakuyena waba umsusa walendaba.
Did Aaron not also deserve to be cut off?
Kwakungafanele yini ukuba noAaron abulawe?
But I think we find part of the answer in Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 20.
Kodwa ngicabanga ukuthi ingxenye yaleyo mpendulo siyayithola encwadini kaDeuteronomy isahluko sika-20.
Deuteronomy 9, verse 20.
Deuteronomy 9, verse 20.
And the Lord was so angry with Aaron that he was ready to destroy him. And I prayed for Aaron also at the same time.
UJehova wathukuthela kakhulu uAaron ukuba ambhubhise, ngamkhulekela uAaron ngaleso sikhathi.
This is what Moses did.
Yilokho uMose akwenza.
He interceded for God to not destroy Aaron.
Wakhuleke enxusa uNkulunkulu ukuba angambhubhisi uAaron.
In the first place, this shows us Moses as a type of Christ.
Lokhu ekuqaleni nje kusikhombisa uMose enjengoKristu.
Christ, who is the big intercessor that intercedes for us in heaven before the Father. But in the second place, it shows you what a blessing it is to have a child of God that can intercede with you and call out with you to the Father for his grace and his mercy. And the Lord was so angry with Aaron that he was ready to destroy him. And I prayed for Aaron also at the same time.
UJehova wathukuthela kakhulu ngo-Aaron ukuba ambhubhise, ngamkhulekela u-Aaron ngaleso sikhathi.
Blessed is the person who has someone he can go to who's reliable and trustworthy, who can intercede for him and pray with you about the burdens that you're carrying.
Ubusisi umuntu nomuntu ongakwazi ukuthi aye kuyena othembekile akhulume naye ukuba amnxusele uNkulunkulu.
Now we come, I want to go back again to the explanation Aaron gave. So let's move back to verse 23.
Exodus 32, verse 23.
This is what Aaron said to Moses. For they said to me, make us gods who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. They had waited, they'd been waiting for Moses. Just think of it. For only 40 days, and they lost their faith. Only 40 days. After all the miracles God performed for them. It took only 40 days without Moses, and they fell back. Friends, to be able to wait upon the Lord and keep your faith is not a small thing.
Ulinde ugcine ukukholwa kwakho akuyona into encane.
Saul missed the Lord's blessing because he was not willing to wait upon the Lord for Samuel to come and sacrifice.
USaul walahlekelwa isibuso sikaNkulunkulu ngokuba wehluleka ukuba alinde enkosini.
He saw his men starting to disappear and run away and be discouraged against the Philistines. There was a big Philistine army against them. And while they were waiting for Samuel to come, Saul saw the men starting to run away and desert. And he couldn't wait anymore. He lost his faith. And he took it into his own hands to sacrifice. How many young people have not made that mistake with marriage? Instead of waiting upon the Lord, making sure that the Lord is calling me into marriage, making sure that the Lord has shown me who to get married to, they simply cannot continue to wait because they are losing their faith in the Lord. Just think. They were on the borders of the promised land, virtually on the borders. If they had a little bit more faith, a little bit more patience. Faith and patience goes together. A man who doesn't have patience to wait upon the Lord does not have faith. Just think of it. They were almost there. Just a little bit more faith. A little bit more patience. A little bit more perseverance in this harsh, hot desert. And they would have been safely brought to the promised land. A little bit more dependence on God. We hate to depend on God. There's no security for us. I want worldly security. Everything in place. My retirement annuity is in place. All the comforts arranged for the day I'm retiring. Because to grow old in dependence on the Lord is too difficult for me. They just had to be a little bit longer dependent on God. And something that started with an excellent, wonderful beginning ended with an unhappy end, a tragic end. They ended all up dying in the desert. This is the fate of the lukewarm Christian. He ends up dying in a spiritual desert.
Ugcina efa efela ehlane lokomoya.
Just that, for those 40 days, just they should have just held out for 40 days. But because they could not do that, they were turned back to go and wander in the desert. For many dreary years. The word that came to my mind was dreary. That was the time, the rest of the time they spent in the desert. So I looked up in the Bible, in a dictionary, what does the word dreary mean? It says, the dictionary says it means depressing. Has the Christian life become depressing to you? The dictionary says it means dull and bleak. There's no excitement. It's dull. There's no color in life. It's all pale. The dictionary says it means repetitive. The same thing every day, repeating the same thing. 40 years in the desert, the same thing, eating the same manna over and over. And the word dreary means uneventful. Nothing really happens. And grueling. It's like grueling. I'm just carrying forward. I don't know what to do. I just carry on. It's grueling in the desert for me. Has your life become like that? Then don't become depressed, even more depressed. And go and want and take your life. No, go to God and repent from your sin. God is a merciful God. Just look how he forgave Aaron. And this is the kind of thing that can make Christianity unbearable to many, many people. They simply cannot bear the Christian life anymore. I'm moving to my last few points. Let's jump to the next chapter, chapter 33, and we read
verse 3.
So now Moses, after he had done this, he goes back up the mountain to speak to God. And the Lord speaks to Moses. And he says, Moses, don't read, I'm not reading yet. He says, Moses, I've had enough of this people. And then he says in verse
3,
go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, but I will not go up among you, lest I consume you on the way. For you are a stiff-necked people. Go up, Moses, he says. I'll keep it for you. When you get there, the land will still be there. It will still be flowing with milk and honey. And you may, will get the grace even to go in. But I will not be among you. I'm not with you among you.
Kodwa uthi mina ngeke ngibe phakathi kwenu, ngeke ngihambe nani.
I'll keep my promise because I promised you the land flowing with milk and honey. So go there. I'll keep my promise, but I will not be among you.
Ngizosigcina isithembiso sami ngoba nganithembisa izwe elichicha umbisi nezinyosi. Ngizosigcina leso sithembiso kodwa mina uqobo ngeke ngihambe nani.
Why?
Ngani na?
Because of the things that had happened.
Ngenxa yezinto ezenzeka.
Because of the golden calf and everything.
Ngenxa lelithole legolide nakho konke.
Things that happened in the past.
Izinto ezenzeka esikhathini esidlule.
No.
Cha.
I cannot go with you because of what I see will happen in the future.
Kodwa ngeke ngihambe nani ngenxa lokho engikubonayo okungase kwenzeke esikhathini esizayo.
I, if I go with you, God says, then I will be consuming you. I will be eating you up as you go. I will end up being your big enemy for you, to you. So Moses, allow me to stand back and you go on your own. Why? Because you're a stiff-necked people. God cannot work with stiff-necked people. And to a certain extent, the Jewish nation still have that trait. Even I've heard a Jew saying in a joke, there's a proverb that says, one Jew, five opinions. Each one goes his own way and fight for his own way. That's why God says, I cannot go with you. I cannot go amongst you. And friends, that is why as we continue with the Christian life, we have to continue to deal with sin in our lives.
To
change as God wants us to change. There should not be any persistent sin in your life that keeps staying there and you don't get rid of it. If I want to follow God and I want Him to be with me and to be a blessing for me, I must be willing to change on the way and to change according to what God wants. Charles Spurgeon spoke about the importance of confessing your sin after your conversion.
Charles Spurgeon wakhuluma ngokubaluleka kokuvuma izono zakho uma usuphendukile.
And he quoted a song.
Wayesecaphuna incwadi yamahubo.
One verse from a song.
Wacaphuna ivesi kwincwadi yamahubo.
Of a person that had repented already.
Ecaphuna ngomuntu owayesephendukile vele.
My sins, my sins, my Savior.
Ethi izono zami msindisi wami.
How sad they fall on thee.
Uthi ziwela phezu kwakho kabuhlungu.
You see, he's developed a love for God.
Uyabona lo muntu se wakheke uthando ngonkulunkulu.
Now he doesn't just see what his sins are doing to himself.
Akabheke nje kuphela uthi lezi zono.
But he saw how it nailed Christ to the cross. Seen through thy gentle patience, I tenfold feel them all. I feel I'm getting even more hurt when I sin, and it's grieving me even more if I sin against you. I know they are forgiven. But still, their pain to me is all the grief and anguish they laid, my Lord, on thee. Do you love the Lord like that? Because he's forgiven you, and you see it hurts you to think how your sins nailed him to the cross. It will make you eager to change as you walk on the way and to get rid of everything in your life and everything in your character that doesn't please God. God must be able to change our attitudes, friends. Otherwise, he's going to become our enemy. He must be able to change our selfishness. We must allow him to change our haughtiness and our pride. We must allow him to change our stubbornness. Otherwise, he will not be a blessing to us as we go through the Christian life. And on the highway of God, you will find yourself stumbling when others are actually walking full of the glory of the Lord, singing and joyful. I want to read, and don't turn there, a verse from Isaiah 14, verse
9.
Whoever is wise, let him understand these things. Whoever has discernment, let him know them. For the ways of the Lord are right, and the upright will walk in them, but transgressors will stumble in them. The same way of God, that is a highway to a person with a soft and a broken heart, becomes a way where another person stumbles all the time. But if we're willing to change, we'll experience us being one with him. The unity with God will grow stronger. He will be in us and we will be in him, as he says. There's a story of a very well-educated American man who spoke to an old African man who was a believer. And this man said to the African old man, "How can you believe the Bible?" Just one example. How can you be in Christ and at the same time he is in you? It doesn't make sense. And the old man looked at him and smiled. He said, "Sir, it's quite simple. Can't you understand it? If I put an iron into burning coals,
Uthi uma ngithatha insimbi ngiyifake emalahleni ashisayo.
You will see the iron heating up and glowing.
Uzoyibona insimbi isha.
The iron is in the coals.
Le nsimbi isemalahleni.
But the coals are in the iron.
Namalahle akuyo insimbi.
This is how it is if we walk humbly with God and allow Him to change us.
Uthi kunjalo uma sihamba noNkulunkulu ngokuzithoba simvumele ukuba siguqule.
Allow me to close with one example.
Vumeleni ngiphethe ngesibonelo sodwa.
In the olden days, they didn't, before they had steel and plastic buckets, they made buckets from wood.
Ensukwini zakuqala kungakabikho amabhakede lawa manje enziwe ngensimbi noma ngoplastiki.
They would put planks in a round circle, like a bucket. Cut them off at the bottom. And put more planks at the bottom. But they had to fit perfectly tight.
Kodwa bekudinga ukuthi lamaplangwe ahlangane elinye eduze kwelinye.
Otherwise, the water would leak out. And one day, an old man who used to make these buckets spoke.
And
he said, you know, the church of Christ is like a wooden bucket. It's not made from one piece of wood. But from many pieces of wood. But they must be tight without a gap between them. You see, friends, if we are one with God, we will be one with each other. It happens automatically. If we are one with God, we are one with each other. The old man says we must there must be no gaps between the us in the church, even though some are big planks and some are thin, fat planks and some are thin planks.
Uthi kumele kuhlangane kungabikho sikhala phakathi kwethu. Noma singalingani abanye bayinkune inkulu abanye bayinkune incane.
And he says the most important planks are the ones right at the bottom of the bucket.
Uthi futhi ezona ingcezu zeinkuni ezibalekile yilezi ezisezantsi phansi ebhakedeni.
They should not leak. It's less, even more important for them not to leak in any way.
Uthi kubaleke kakhulu kulezo kuba zingavuzi nakancane.
Interesting, don't you think so? That's how the Christian life is. When you're at the bottom, or it feels to you as if you're at the bottom, it's more important for you to stay one with the other children of God than when you are at the top. But because if there's one hole between the planks, the water will run out and the whole purpose of the bucket is lost. I don't know whether you've ever felt I'm at the bottom. I'm just nothing here. I'm just nobody. It's more important for you to stay in the Lord and to stay one with the children of God than for anybody else in the church of God. He says, if there's a little stone between the planks, or a little stick, the water will leak out there. He says, what is a little plank and a little stick and a little stone? He He says it's the little quarrels amongst us. The hard words we speak to another brother. Just a little bit of dirty money in your life, money that you know is not a blessing, but you're keeping it. It won't just hurt you. The whole church will be hurt through it. And the water will run out, and many people will stumble and fall because there's this thing between you and a brother. He says it's a proud or an unforgiving spirit. This old man lived many years ago. I can tell you his name. Samuel
Hebich.
He lived many years ago. But this principle suits today. He says, a proud or an unforgiving spirit is going to make a gap between you and the other children of God. So friends, do we find ourselves in that position? Then this message today is not to condemn you and say you can never meet the Lord. It's supposed to lead to godly remorse. And remember, godly remorse leads to repentance. It makes me think of what Oswald Chambers said. He said, to us, very often our destination, where we're going to, is the most important thing. But it says in God's kingdom, how we get there is sometimes more important than the place we are going to. And it was more important for God that Israel get to the promised land in submission and being one with Him and keeping the faith in Him than to get to the promised land. Remember that. How you get to heaven one day is more important to God than just getting to heaven.
Ukuthi ofika kanjani khona ikhona okubaleka kakhulu uNkulunkulu kunokuthi ufike khona.